Well, morning, y'all.
Good morning.
I've been in Texas the last week, and so sometimes those slip out. Now, this morning, if you hear an all y'all, you know I've been too long in at the workshop at sunset. What a blessing that is. I would hope maybe next year we'll get a large group of us to go to that workshop. It is, it's an amazing time, and you get to meet all kinds of people from all over the world. I sat and talked for quite a while with Jim and Billy McGuigan, and if I start talking about the wee things of life, you'll know that I was with the Irish folks and spent a lot of time with Bahailu Ababa, who is from Ethiopia, and so if I start slipping off into Amharic, you'll know why. But I mean, it's a great time because literally you can see how people from all over the world are gathering. And just a great time to be fed and encouraged and meet folks. So maybe next year we'll have a large group that will go. Turn with me this morning, if you will, to the second chapter of the Revelation. One of the things that I find fascinating is when you hear people talk about the Revelation, most people that you hear refer to it as revelations. I've done really good about not bringing that up thus far in our series, but you know, I can't go through a whole series and not touch on that, because really there's only one revelation. It's not revelations. It's just the revelation that was given by God to his son, to John, via an angel that would be sent to the churches. And so we have here, literally, it's a letter from God himself that he sent through his son. And it identifies some of the things that Jesus thinks of us. Isn't that interesting? You ever wonder what Jesus thinks of you? Because oftentimes we wonder what other people think about us. And in fact, sometimes we'll dress a certain way because of what people think about us, or we'll dress a certain way to make people think a certain thing about us. And here we get to find out what Jesus thinks about us, about what Jesus thinks of his people. Don't think of this as the church on some corporate level. This is what Jesus thinks of his people. And some of those people are gathered together in certain locations, Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, and so on. And some of his people are gathered together in Corona. And so what does he think of us? What does he think of our families? What is going on in our families? But what does he think about what's going on in our own minds, in our own hearts? What do we think about him? How does that play into everyday life? That's what Smyrna is faced with in Revelation chapter 2, beginning in verse 8. To the angel of the church in Smyrna write, the words of the first and the last who died and who came to life. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich. And the slander of those who say that they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. Smyrna is a persecuted church. They're being attacked and pressured from influences outside of their assembly, outside of their gathering. And so when we look at some of the conditions One of the things that is paramount in this book, ultimately, the bottom line is that there's going to be a reward for faithfulness. And so what I want us to see is our reward for faithfulness, but what I want us to see is how we get there. What does it mean to be faithful, and how does it look like as we live our lives? And then what is the reward for faithfulness? We're going to look at some of those things, but first of all, I want to look at the conditions that are in Smyrna. I want to spend a little time just offering some background. I mean, when you look at the conditions, I mean, Jesus says they're poor. Literally translated, it means they're destitute of any worldly goods or possessions. But they live in an extremely affluent area. This is one of the major ports along the Aegean Sea. It's second only to the ports of Ephesus. There's a great deal of trade and commerce that's going on in Smyrna. It is a wealthy city. But Jesus says they are poor. Does that speak of their persecution? You see that? They're poor. They're destitute. The picture you see here is of what you and I would call a poor congregation. This is in Hosanna, Ethiopia. This is the picture you see is the church. Okay? That's it. Maybe about 50 people, if that. And so they don't have a lot. They're in the southern part of Ethiopia, and they're not known for their wealth or anything like that. They're certainly not in the major metropolis of Addis Ababa. But they have a desire. They want to host the next annual preachers' conference. Well, I say annual. They have it like every 2 years. But the next one is in 2017. And they want to host it right there. So this little church, poor as they are, they have raised 3,000 birr. That doesn't mean much to you, does it? 3,000 birr would be about the equivalent of about $1,400. Okay? We will give maybe three times that amount just today. Maybe four or five times that amount. Maybe, I don't know, maybe 10 times that amount today. Just throwing that out there. It's just an idea. But we give a whole lot more than that every Sunday. And we collect that. They have gathered that together so that they can pay for the speakers who come to stay in the hotels in the area. They are raising the funds to make that happen. And they've already raised about 3,000 birr. In a very poor congregation. Jesus says to the people in Smyrna, I know you're poor. I know your poverty. I know that you are destitute. But you are rich. Well, look at what else is going on. They're being pressured by non-Christians. The idea of this tribulation or this pressure, it comes from the Greek word thlipsis, which simply means a pressing together. It's what's used when they talk about pressing the grapes. When they're seeking to get the juice and the fruit of the vine from the grape, they will press them together. They will smash them, and you can understand the pressure. They'll do the same thing with the olives to get the oil. You can imagine the pressure that is used to extract all of that. And these people are facing that same kind of pressure. Jesus says it's from people who claim to be Jews, but they're not. If you want to know more details about all of these things, come to Bible class. We're studying these, and we're going to start looking at all of these churches individually next week. So come and see. It's the idea of affliction. People are placing all kinds of demands upon them. The government of Rome is placing all kinds of demands on these people to compromise their faith, to compromise the truth that they know, and they're refusing. Oh, it's a beautiful picture. But there are demands for compromise. We'll see how that plays out as we look through this. There's some legal oppression that's taking place. Jesus says you're going to be thrown into prison. And some of you won't make it out alive. You're going to die. That's encouraging news, isn't it? Wouldn't you like to get a letter like that? You're going to be in prison. And you're going to die there, maybe. But take heart, because you can still conquer. And I'm thinking, what do you mean conquer? You're telling me I'm going to die. How is that conquering? You see, there's more to life than just this life. because that's the promised reward. I will give you the crown of life. There is praise for this congregation. In fact, that's all they receive. There's only two churches among these seven who receive only praise. There's no condemnation. Philadelphia is the other one. Smyrna is only praise. There's no call to repent. And there is a promise of the crown of life. Does that sound like any conditions we face in America today? Is there a call for us to compromise our convictions every day? Some people have already compromised their convictions today. Because the world places all of these demands upon us. And we cave in to those demands. We think, well, I can't go without this. I'd really like to do this. And so we compromise. There's legal oppression that's being faced. There's a couple in Oregon who may very well lose their cake decorating business because they refuse to compromise, and they're facing legal oppression for that because their convictions tell them what weddings they can support and what weddings they can't. You see, this is happening here. The question is, will we remain faithful? Will we stand up for those convictions? Let's take a moment and define faithfulness. Because we always talk about faithfulness. What does that mean? What does that look like when we define faithfulness? Where does faith come from? Hearing the Word of God. Romans 10:17, right? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And as we live by faith, we live by the Word of God. Faithfulness is living by the Word of God in its truest sense. It's an unfailing devotion and conviction in the midst of whatever pressures that we might face, whatever experiences we might endure, whatever temptations might be flying in our face, whatever appeals to us, whatever desires that we might have. Means that we will not compromise what the Bible says, what the Bible tells us, where the Bible leads us for any of these other things that life offers. That's my kind of take on faithfulness. Work it out. Faithfulness. Faithfulness. Hebrews 11. You can see faithfulness, can't you? That is faithfulness. By faith, Abel offered a sacrifice that was better than his brother's. It doesn't say by faith Abel believed in God. No, his faithfulness was seen in the way he responded to the Word of God. That's faithfulness. We can go through the whole list of Hebrews chapter 11, and you see that in everybody. By faith, they did this. By faith, they did that. By faith, they're always doing. Faith is always seen in the way we live our lives. Faith is seen by the way we order our lives. It is seen in the priorities that we apply to our lives. That's where faith is seen. That's where we see faith here in the Revelation, in Smyrna. Because these people have an unfailing devotion and a conviction in the midst of some very difficult experiences. That's what we see. Faith. Faithfulness is described in marriage, isn't it? When we take our marriage vows, when I took my marriage vows almost 31 years ago, I cannot believe she has tolerated me that long. But anyway, I'm blessed that she has. But when I took my marriage vows, we gave each other rings, right? This, many of you have done that as well. We said, with this ring I thee wed. One of the vows that we took says, I will be faithful to you until death. And we say that. I say that every time I perform the wedding ceremony. Will you be faithful to him or to her as long as you both shall live? I do. That's the idea of faithfulness. That's the picture of faithfulness between the Lord and his people. Did you know that we who are Christians in this room Did you know that we are all brides? Collectively, we are the bride of Christ. In Ephesians chapter 5, do you know what Jesus, you know what Paul is talking about? He's talking about the relationship between Christ, the groom, and the church, his bride. And we use that and we apply that to marriage today. I don't think we're wrong in doing that, but I think we need to understand Paul is talking about Christ and the church. It's a relationship. And to be unfaithful in that relationship is to commit adultery. That's the idea of the new covenant. That's why God knew that there needed to be a new covenant. God says through Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 to 34, he says, in those days I will create a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not like the covenant I made with their fathers that they broke, although I was a husband to them. They broke that covenant. In other words, God's people committed adultery and broke the covenant. They were unfaithful. You see, that's the picture of faithfulness. That's what God is looking for, because we're the bride of Christ. And we must remain faithful. We must never, ever consider cheating on Jesus. There's so many passages that we can look at. In the context of Smyrna, these people must maintain their conviction for both the identity and the ability of Jesus. His identity is seen as in that he is the Christ. Jesus is Lord. I mean, look at how he addresses them. The words of the first and the last, who was dead and who now came to life. He is the one who conquers death. That's why Paul would write in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? Thanks be to God that we have that victory through Jesus Christ. Read that passage for yourself and understand the victory that we have because he was victorious. Listen, Jesus tells these people, your faithfulness is going to be tested. And look at where it's tested. Their faithfulness is tested in all of these difficult circumstances. Faithfulness is not tested when life is like a bowl of cherries, or when life is like a box of chocolate, you see. Faithfulness is really tested when difficulties arise. We don't like that, do we? The Lord's faithfulness was tested when he was hungry. He hadn't eaten for 40 days and 40 nights, and his faithfulness was tested. You see, it's in difficult circumstances where that will happen, and you have to maintain your identity of Jesus. Jesus had to maintain his conviction for his own identity when he was tempted with the devil. But we also need to see his ability. He was dead, and he came to life. He has the ability to conquer death, and because he did, we can. And so he tells these people, look, your faithfulness is going to be tested, and some of you are going to die because of it. But you need to stand tall. You need to stand firm. You need to maintain your conviction, because in the end, you will win. You see, that's the beautiful message of the Revelation, is that we win. Richard Rogers, when he wrote his commentary on Revelation, he simply titled the book, Hallelujah Anyway. Regardless of what happens, hallelujah. We might die, but we will be faithful and we will be rewarded. And so we need to see how that is lived out, tested in our tribulation, tested among the difficulties, among the pressures and under the demands that are placed upon us. How will we stand? Literally, when Jesus says to be faithful unto death, literally it means to prove yourselves faithful. Prove yourselves faithful. Don't just say you're faithful. You know, I go to church every Sunday morning. Sometimes I go on Sunday nights. And occasionally I might show up on a Wednesday night, but I'm faithful because I'm there on Sunday morning. Is that our measurement for faithfulness? Oh, it might be one thing. It might be one element of life that we use to determine faithfulness, but that's not the only thing. It can't be, because there's six other days in the week by which our faithfulness is tested. How much testing of your faith is going on right now? Probably not much. How much will be going on tomorrow morning when you get back to work and when you get back to school? You see? We got to think about how faithfulness is lived out. We sing this song. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. And that's exactly what we've got to do. Stand up. And when somebody tells you something that's different than what the Bible says, you need to lovingly, tenderly, not confrontationally, let them know that's not what the Bible says. That's not what Jesus is looking for. When somebody calls into question the identity of Jesus, you need to say, look, he has to be who he said he was because he did the things he promised to do. He said that he would suffer, be killed, buried, and would rise again on the third day and then ascend to sit with the Father in heaven. And there are people who saw him do that. So don't tell me that Jesus is just a myth. There's too much historical evidence to prove beyond the shadow of a doubt that he is the Son of God and that the Bible is the Word of God. You got to stand up for those things. There's going to be pressure for you to compromise your faith and to back down, especially in this age of intolerance. I said age of intolerance. I said this in Bible class this morning, but all of the people who are demanding that we be tolerant are the ones who are intolerant of what the Bible says and the way we think. They won't tolerate that. That's why they want us to be tolerant, you see. The people who are calling for tolerance are the ones who are intolerant. Oh, society is amazing, isn't it? You got to stand up for that, knowing we also have to know our position as being subjects under his reign. That's what it means for Christ to be Lord. Listen, in Smyrna, as they're being pressured into acknowledging Caesar as Lord. Now that's part of the law that's handed down. You have to say Caesar is Lord. It's like Nazi Germany when you had to say Heil Hitler. You had to say Caesar is Lord. Well, Christians wouldn't do that because they knew Caesar wasn't Lord. He might think he is, and other people might be believing that. Listen, the vast majority of people might be believing that. But just because the majority of people say that doesn't mean that it's right. And Christians would not say Caesar is Lord because they knew Jesus to be Lord. So what does that mean? It means that I'm a subject under his reign. I do what he tells me to do. I live to honor him instead of me. I live for his desires instead of my own. That's what it means to live under the reign of any monarchy. And so we need to understand the lordship of Christ. You see in this picture here, we're handing one of the solar players to Brother Demise. Brother Bahailu is the one in the green shirt. Brother Demise is the one in the sport coat. He's receiving the solar player, and he's a preacher in the Lord's church because his father was killed for being a Christian. In the 70s in Ethiopia, there was a rule by the Italian government, or the communist government, and one of the, they killed their emperor, Haile Selassie. He was in his 80s, and a new regime came in and took over. His name was Mengistu, and he killed Haile Selassie. He took over, and he demanded that people renounce Christ or Jesus as Lord. And Brother Demasi's father refused to do that. He was seized and arrested by communists. This is in the 1970s. And they said, if you do not denounce Christ, you will be killed. And he says, you do to me what you want to do to me, but I will never denounce Jesus. And so they said, well, we're not going to waste a bullet on you. Christians are not worth a bullet. So they laid him down on the ground, held him down, held his mouth open, and as they tell me the story, they poured a bottle, an entire bottle of white lightning down his throat and made him drink the entire bottle all at once. And in a couple days, he was dead. Because under that communist regime, he refused to denounce Jesus as Lord. And as he was dying over those next couple days, his greatest wish, he spoke with Bahailu and told Bahailu this is what he wanted. I want my son to preach the gospel in my place. And in Ethiopia, the children have such an honor for their parents that they will honor those wishes. And his son is now one of the greatest preachers in Ethiopia. He's got his own conviction, but he's living up to his father's wishes to preach the gospel. His father was killed because he wouldn't deny the lordship of Jesus. He says, I'm a subject under his reign, and I will not deny that fact. So they made him drink this white lightning, and he died. And his son has carried on that legacy. I hope it never comes to that in the United States. How do we deny our connection to Jesus? There's three things I think we do. We disregard what he says, we disagree with what he says, and we disobey what he says. Those are three ways that we deny his lordship. It's like Peter. He denied Jesus. I don't know that guy. Instead of having that conviction, now Peter will repent of that. Peter will be restored on the shores of Galilee when they're eating breakfast together. And Peter will be the one who will preach the sermon at Pentecost. And Peter will be the one who to be crucified upside down because he's not worthy to be crucified the same way Jesus was. But there was a time. And maybe there was a time with you. Maybe recently. When you said, no, I don't know him. Somebody challenges what the Bible says, and whatever. And we fail to stand. We deny our Lord. But faithfulness will be rewarded. When we stand up for Jesus. Faithfulness is rewarded. Because Jesus says there is the crown of life. The crown really is the Stephanos crown. There's two crowns in the Bible. One is the diadem and one is the Stephanos. The diadem, that's the crown of royalty. And some people say that this is what Jesus is talking about with Smyrna. You'll receive the crown of royalty because you get to sit with Jesus. You get to reign with Christ. Now, we do that as Christians, don't we? Oh, that's awesome! But I think what he's talking about here more is the Stephanos crown, because he's talking about being conquerors. He's talking about being victorious. He's talking about overcoming all of the pressures and all of the demands that are being placed on them. Even if they die, you get the crown. You see, Smyrna was a town that looked like a crown. On the hills of Smyrna, there was an Acropolis on the top of the hill of Smyrna that was just up from one of their two harbors. And it looked like a crown. And they called it the city of the crown. Sounds like a city close to here, doesn't it? What is a corona? It's a crown. Oh, we've got something in common. Isn't that awesome? And so it looked like that. Jesus says, I'll give you the crown of life. Paul talks about it as an incorruptible crown in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. To Paul, he would tell him that there lays in store for me this crown of righteousness. James talks about it as the crown of life. Peter says it is the crown of glory that never fades, 1 Peter chapter 5. That's the crown of glory, of righteousness, that is incorruptible. That's the crown of life. That's the crown that I will give you, because you will be victorious. Some of you are going to prison, and some of you are going to die, but yet you will be victorious. Because Jesus reminds us that there's more to life than just this life. So just like Brother Dennis says, Father, you do to me what you want to do. He was victorious. They poured that liquor down his throat, and 2 days later, he was dead. Oh, but you see, the one who writes the letter says, I died too. But I am now alive. And because I died and came to life, even if you die, you'll come to life. You see, we don't know a lot about that. We've never been on the other side. We don't know what it's like. Oh, the Bible gives us some glimpses into what it's like. The rich man and Lazarus, as Lazarus sits in the bosom of Abraham. Well, we get a glimpse into what it's like. Jesus says to the man on the cross, today you will be with me in paradise. And our mind instantly goes to Hawaii. Let me tell you, I think the paradise of God is so much better than Hawaii. No offense. But it's with Jesus. Oh, that's the victory. That's the crown of life. Let me ask you this question. When Jesus says, be faithful unto death, and literally what that means is be faithful in the face of death. They are facing death. It's a reality, and it's somewhat of a certainty. And so in the face of death, just like Brother Demise's father, in the face of death, you be faithful. And I will give you the crown of life. So let me ask you this question. Do we deserve the crown of life because we've been faithful? Or does he deserve our faithfulness because he was faithful? Are we looking for something that we earn and deserve? Or is he? There's encouragement from the one who is speaking, from the one who was dead and is now alive. The words of the first and the last. Because you see, caving into the pressures of our society is not worth giving up Christ. And he says, to him who overcomes, to him who conquers. This is the last thing I want to share with you this morning, because it's probably the most prominent thing you see day in and day out. In fact, I'll bet that some people have this emblem on their person right now. Anybody have this on them? Anybody wearing Nike shoes? Nike shirt? Because the Greek word for overcome there is nikao, which is where we get the word Nike. It's the word for victory. It's the word for conquering. It's the word for overcoming. So next time you see that, might be on an advertisement this afternoon if any of you watch football games or whatever. Whenever you see this, remember, you've got the victory. You don't need that little swoosh on the side of your shoe. You've got the promise of God, because to him who overcomes. And every time you see that little swoosh, you can know that I can overcome. Regardless of the pressures that life places on me, regardless of the demands of the society in which I live, regardless of of the call for compromise in my convictions. Regardless for questioning what the Bible says, I can overcome. And I must overcome. Because Jesus overcame. He was killed. He came to life. And so can we. So can we. Demasi's father did. People in Smyrna did. Jesus did. And so the question this morning is, how tall will we stand? How strong will we stand? And as subjects under his reign, how willingly will we be to surrender our all to Jesus? That's the song we're going to sing. Let's sing that. Let's stand together and let's sing that now. And if you need to surrender to Jesus, now's the time to make that choice.